Hello everyone, this is Inter. On a live stream with Vaos last night, we were looking at Vaos making some of these things, electrical driven propellers for planes. And I thought I'd give it a try myself this morning. Well, it's like noon, but anyway. So this one pretty much works. It can get off the ground. It doesn't do very high speeds, like it struggles to reach 30 meters per second, but it does all right. So I'm going to go through a little semi-tutorial type thing and try to recreate the engine before your eyes, and if you want to go ahead and replicate this, feel free. Of course, I do have to apologize for the quality of the video. I do not have a graphics card in my computer right now because it had to be sent back to the manufacturer. So I'm doing all this off of the CPU, so I've turned lots of settings down. I'm running with just normal render, not high quality renders, normal quality textures. The render rate is really slow. I turned anti-aliasing off, so you'll see lots of jagged edges. But anyway, that's the little stuff. All right, so we start out with a couple of fuselages. Now this design, of course I watched Vaos do this, and he told me that he was imitating a design by MrNuclearturkey, and I'll have a link for him in the description. So MrNuclearturkey's design began with something like this. We take a little blue separatron. It separates on both sides, so it doesn't put any undue force on either sides, and he puts that inside the fuselages. Of course, to put it inside the fuselages, we have to turn on part clipping. So turn that on, and then I'm going to put this inside the fuselages here, if I can get my camera close enough. And we want it, let's see, ahead of the cockpit. And then just for safe measure, I'm going to turn the force of the decoupler all the way off. That way we don't have to worry about it accidentally blowing up on something or blowing something else up. Now, through the length of these two fuselage pieces, we're going to be putting the electrical engine, which is going to operate all these little SAS, torque module things. So we'll put those in there. And because this is electrically driven, I did want to regenerate some power somehow. So I opted to go with the design of using generators inside as the axis, axle of the propeller. So this will go all the way through. I'll just start adding in generators. There we go. I think I have room for one more, maybe two more. No, just one more. All right, so five generators in this design. And onto the end of both of these, I'm going to cap a little battery here. So we'll put that there. And actually, because we're going to run out of the room at the end of this, I'm going to turn off angle snap down here at the bottom, turn off angle snap, and offset this back a little bit toward the rear of the plane until it's just touching the first generator there. Go all the way down to the other end and do basically the same. So let's see, we'll take the generators off, slap our battery onto the decoupler, holding down Alt, we can get the generators to snap back into place, and then I'm going to turn on the translational offset tool and slide it back toward the battery, and that should save us enough end on both ends of the prop axle that we can actually fit the entire thing inside the fuselage. Okay. So of course, to apply the torque to get the propeller to turn, we need to start adding in these SAS modules that I grabbed. So I'll put one right there, and another one down at the other end. And where'd it go? Let's see. One of these down here. Come on. There it is. Okay. And then I will add a few more in at every junction along the radiator axle. So let's see, we'll put one right there. And I'll show you what I'm about to do with these things in a moment to maximize the torque. Alright, at the front of each generator right there, we now have a little torque module. Now, torque in KSP, or the torque modules here, they work a little funny. So let me throw on something just so we're not being distracted. Put on a little cap right there. And let me get one of these torque modules. And onto one side of this, I'm going to apply a little battery so you can follow the light as I turn it. And this is just demonstrating something I'm going to talk about here. So in KSP, the torque modules are the reaction wheels. If you look at the right side where it says reaction wheel and it has pitch torque, yaw torque, and roll torque, they all say 15.0. Well, KSP may be trying to apply that much torque, and the electrical draw, regardless of whatever plane of rotation you're rotating the vehicle in, the reaction wheels will be consuming the same amount of electricity because they're trying to put out as much torque as they can do. But in practice, I have found, and I've actually been told this in the past and verified it, at least in recently, that the reaction wheels do not put out the same amount of torque force in all planes of rotation. So if I highlight this, So if I highlight this reaction wheel here with like the translational tool, what I'm first going to do is, and I have to be very careful with my adverbs here, I'm going to rotate it around the blue arrow, and if I turn over to the rotation tool, I'm going to rotate it along the green circle. So watch what I do here. So if I grab the wheel, number one, and I start rotating it in any given direction. So let's say we're turning it clockwise as you're looking at it right now. There we go. So I'm rotating it around the forward-facing blue arrow of the translational tool, and I'm rotating it along the green circle of the rotational tool. Now in this direction, we are you can see we're rotating with the circular shape of the reaction wheel. So when you're rotating a vehicle, doing any sort of rotation along with the circular shape of the reaction wheel, this is the motion of rotation in which the reaction wheel puts out the least amount of torque in practice. It'll be trying to put out the same amount of torque, but I found in practice it just doesn't. It doesn't seem to give as much oomph or force or whatever as you'd like. So looking back in here at our engines, at the moment we can currently see that all the reaction wheels are lined up so that when the propeller starts turning, they are going to be, the propeller is going to be turning in the direction that these SAS modules are, going back to old versions of KSPs, that these reaction wheels are going to be turning in direction that these reaction wheels will be able to provide the least amount of torque. And that's not going to help us a lot. I want to get as much torque as possible out of the engine. So what I'm going to do now is turn most of these reaction wheels, not the end ones, I'll leave the end ones alone, but I'm going to turn most of the reaction wheels so that they are perpendicular with the axis of the engine. And then when they start to rotate around the axis of the engine, they'll be in a plane of rotation that is allowing them to provide their more optimal amounts of torque. So let me demonstrate. So this one, Let's just go back to that. Okay, with the offset tool. Okay, so we got the rotation tool here, and I'm leaving angle snap turned on. So with the rotation tool turned on and angle snap turned on, I'm going to rotate this so it's perpendicular with the plane of rotation here. So let's go like this. And yes, you can see it's offset a little bit. We'll come back and fix that in a moment. And then for the next one, I'll go the opposite direction. I'll use the blue circle and rotate it again. And we'll just go back and forth. Come on, one more. My mouse is not cooperating. It's very humid today, so my mouse is sticking to the mouse pad. It makes me worry about my computer fans. Okay, so now we'll use the offset tool, and again, this is with angle snap turned on, so that all I have to do, I don't have to drag any arrows, all I have to do is just touch the red arrow here, in this case, and the piece should snap into the center of the rotation, or the center of the engine axle. So I'm just going to touch it, get it to highlight, and touch it, There we go. And now the SAS module, you know what I mean. The module is now in the middle of the axle. And again, with the upward facing one, I'm just going to touch the green arrow here and it should snap into place. There we go. And do that for the last couple of modules here. Ta-da! And ta-da. Okay. So now everything's lined up in the middle. Looks good. Alright, so that is our engine not quite complete. There are some other things I can do. I could add in more batteries, I could add in more torque modules, but I've found, I did some practices on the plane I showed you at the start of this video, and this is the exact same engine that I have. This seems to be sufficient. If you want to add more torque modules, you might get a faster engine rotation speed, and that obviously would help with your forward velocity, but this is fine for me. This seems to work. But you'll notice, of course, that the parts here are kind of sitting right in the middle of the fuselage, surrounded by a lot of air. And as soon as we hit this decoupler at the back, the blue decoupler, as soon as we detach that, and again, I'm really sorry for the texture resolution here, my poor computer is struggling. As soon as we detach this, these things are just going to fall to the ground. They're going to fall onto the floor of the inner fuselage. So to keep them from moving as much, from falling as much, we can add in a couple of Stay Putnik probes. Probodobodyne, whatever that's called. Stay Putnik. So I'm going to grab one of these, and I'm going to attach it to this... Come on, where are you? There we go. So I'm going to attach it to the generators here. Oh, this is what happens when you stay up until 4 in the morning with Vaos. Alright, so we get the Stay Putnik probe at the back, and unfortunately it sticks out a little bit far. It's almost touching the back of the fuselage, and I don't want it to rub against the cockpit, so I'm going to grab it with a translational tool and angle snap turned off, and I'm just going to slide this forward so it's not touching anything. Come on, work with me here. There we go. And if I want to get in really close, I'll put it right up to the trailing edge of the battery. There we go. That's good. Now you could add more in here. I believe at Vaos, at one point Vaos was doing three of them, trying to get like ball bearing effect going around, so he was covering the whole space. I'm not going to get that complicated. This is okay. It's not. It doesn't make for a perfect engine, but it's okay. And you can see because the Stay Putnik probes are a wider diameter than the rest of the parts, it fills up more of the space inside this fuselage, and so that's really going to help with keeping the axle centered inside. Alright, so I'll come down to the other end and put in another one, because we only need one at either end, really. Once this thing, here I'll show with a wing to show what I'm saying. So once this thing is released, you know, once I let gravity take over and I fire off this little blue decoupler at the back, and the axle, oh, the engine just sort of settles with gravity. What's going to happen is, because the propeller is at the front of the engine, it's going to be heavier at the front, and it'll sort of sag like that. See how I'm rotating the wing? It'll sort of sag like that. And then when it starts pulling in the air, you know, it might pull itself up a little bit, but either way, all we really have to anchor down is the two opposing ends of the engine. So I'm only going to put a Stay Putnik, one at either end. So one Stay Putnik at the back, which we have, and now I'm going to add another one at the front, and we don't need this anything. This is just for demonstration, so I can just get rid of that. Go inside and add a Stay Putnik here. There we go. And again, turn angle snap off, translational tool on, slide toward the back so it's not in the way of anybody. And there we go. That is our engine complete. Now it's just a matter of adding in the propeller and, of course, turning this cockpit into a plane. So let's do that. I'll pause the video just to make sure I don't lose all of my recording at once, and we'll come back and put the engine on. Okay, so now let's put that engine on. And MrNuclearturkey had a pretty clever solution for this. He rotated the engine cowling, if you like. He rotated that upward just to make sure there would be no accidental attachment of the wrong parts to the wrong surfaces. Okay, so I'm not going to go into depth on this. Mr. Nuclear Turkey covered the reasons why we're doing this. Basically, we're just trying to put an end cap onto the engine cowling. Let me show you what I mean. So I'm going to put an end cap, like so, onto the engine cowling. And that is going to keep the engine inside these hollow fuselage pieces. But also, we need to have the propeller be on the outside of the fuselage pieces. So I'm also going to put one of these onto this, onto the engine axle. And then it's just a matter of getting this to come out as far as... Oh, come on. Getting the second battery here to come out as far as possible so that when we rotate the cowling back into place, you can see the engine attached battery is now outside and it can freely rotate. And just slide it back so it's almost touching. Good enough. Okay. And then we can go and let me just put a little antenna on here so we mark the difference. So the battery with the antenna is attached to the fuselage and should not move. The battery ahead of it should move because it is attached to the engine. Okay, so now we'll add in, let's say, a couple more batteries. And we can start adding in our propellers. Let's see, just for a visual effect, we'll put one of these on the front, even though it doesn't need it, because there's actually no airflow at all. and for propellers, this, you really just have to play with it, experiment with it. I'll imitate the last plane I just did. So you turn on radial symmetry, get four propellers on here, and let's rotate them. Well, let's see. We want the propeller to resemble real-life American planes, so it'll have to rotate clockwise as the pilot is looking at it from back here. So the engine would have to go like from top side, it would have to rotate over to the right clockwise. So I'm going to turn these. Nope, good grief. Propellers only. There we go. Turn them so they are traveling with the rotation to the right. Now, how much you angle them, like, do you want to angle them this much? Do you want to angle them just a little bit? How much you do, it depends on the part that you're using, how fast your engine can rotate, what sort of stresses the engine can withstand. So a lot of this is just experimentation, and I only just experimented with this for a few minutes before starting to do this video, so I really don't have all the techniques worked out. But one thing I found that you can do, and I think MrNuclearturkey mentioned this, is you can, in flight, adjust the deployment of the flaps to play with how much forward lift you get from these little propeller pieces. So I'm going to do that. Well, first I should take off all of these. And let's see, which direction does it deploy? No, we want to go in the other direction. So let's see, it'll deploy back that way. And I don't want to go that much. Let's take this down a few notches. Just a little bit of deployment. Maybe something for takeoff, and then once we're in flight, we can cruise it out. So we have a variable pitch propeller. Okay, good enough. Now, one other thing I found that does matter is if you have these propeller pieces too close to the center of the engine, too close to the axle, they are not getting enough... I don't know if you can see my flickering mouse here. They don't get enough traveling velocity. They don't get enough angular velocity because they're too close to the engine. So it helps if we slide them out like so. And the farther you slide them out, of course, the more rotational velocity they'll have, just like a record player. And they can provide more lift this way. Of course, the problem with this is you now have a very, very large propeller for a rather small plane. So, it doesn't work the best. Let me attach some things on here. We'll quickly round out this plane, make it look presentable, like the previous one I showed you. Now, of course, if I turn on center of mass and center of lift and stuff, which I will do, hang on a second, I will do that, but you'll notice that because the propellers are in place, we're going to get some really wild readings on the center of lift. But it is still relevant to see where everything sits together, because they will be two traveling bodies in air, and they will be affecting each other. So as the plane pushes on the propeller, as the plane pushes on the engine axle, you know, they'll be fighting against each other inside. So it's helpful to know where their center of masses are. You can see it's mostly at the back of the engine. If I turn on center of lift here, yeah, so that's showing, of course, the propellers. If I move it forward, or not forward, if I take it off, you can then see that the center of lift of the plane is ahead of the center of mass. There's not a whole lot we can do about that. I mean, I could try to make the plane heavier, but I really don't want to. So reattach the propeller and see if I can slide the wings back a bit without compromising ground clearance for the propeller. That should be okay. Yeah, it's better at least. Okay, so that'll work. Again, this doesn't have to be perfect. Okay, so now we can save this as something new. Let's see. Prop plane. And now we can go fly it. Okay, so here we go. Actually, I'm a bit worried about that antenna. I probably should have moved the antenna backwards. Oh, we just might not be able to use the trim option. It might get in the way. Oh, you know what I forgot to do? I forgot to offset the decoupler. So if I decouple this right now, the decoupler just stays inside. I don't want it to create extra friction. So let me go back and redo that one small step that's actually kind of important. Okay, so angle snap on, translational offset tool. Let's get in there and get the decoupler out of the way, so that when we actually detach the engine, it doesn't, you know, interfere with everything else. I'm going to go back in here, and I believe the batteries were the first thing I added. So we'll put these back up as far as they will go on their own. Alright, and let's get back to the decoupler. And now with angle snap turned off, we're going to fine-tune the placement. So first I want to get it backwards so that the batteries are touching again. Maybe not quite touching. And then I'm going to use green arrow here, vertically raise them up so the pieces are in line. And this doesn't matter too much because, you know, once we decouple the pieces, they'll just fall into the fuselage anyway. And there we go. So now everything's back in place. And you can see the decoupler is mostly outside, so when we release it, it should just fall to the ground. Alright, let's save again and try again. Okay. So of course this is an electrically driven plane, so we don't need throttle. I can kill that. And let's turn on and see what we got. So altogether, with all these batteries, it has quite a bit of juice. Let's decouple them so we have one plane and one engine. There we go, that fell out. And I'll just tab over to the engine here. And let's see if it rotates. Now, to rotate it, fortunately, the nav ball here is referencing one of the state buttons that is facing forward. So this works to our advantage. I can just use the right rotating key, just like if I'm flying the plane, just right rotating key, and it rotates on its own. But it doesn't stay rotating. To keep it rotating continuously, we need to use the trim commands. And by default, I believe that's hold down Alt and E. I have my keyboard set up a little bit differently, but I believe default is Alt and E to rotate to the right. So we're just holding down Alt and holding down E, and You can see the roll meter down here is sliding gradually to the right. And there we go. It's at full trim. Tab back to the plane. And we're already traveling at 19 meters per second. So it works. Turn on SAS so we don't go too much out of control. And I'm also going to turn on the aerodynamic forces overlay. And now we can see what kind of forward thrust the propellers are generating. And if we don't like the amount of thrust that they're generating, if it's not sufficient to get our plane off the ground, we... Oh dear. We can go back and adjust that either in the editor by changing the angle of attachment or by just using the deploy feature. So let's try both of those. Let's see. Here. I should as well just set on deploy right now. Hopefully that antenna still isn't in the way. Now if it gets up to 30 meters per second, it should take off. But it doesn't look like it's going to. Okay, well you get the idea, so let me go back to the plane that I know works, and we'll launch that one and you can see it take off. Okay, here we go. This is the plane that I already have that works. Forgot to put a SAS module in the back, that's okay. Alright, so let's decouple here. Turn on forces. And this should take off. Maybe it needs a little bit of encouragement. There we go. Now again, because of all of the different variables with the engine designs that you can do, like what sort of propeller pieces you're using, I chose these ones because they have a pretty good lift factor. I believe it's like 0.77 lift surface area. So pretty good lifting force for their physical dimensions. So I thought that would be a pretty good piece to use. You might choose to use other pieces. You might choose to build smaller or larger propellers, like propeller arc diameter. For me, for this plane, it seems to be enough. Actually, what is our total mass here? So mass of the plane is 3.85 tons. And mass of the propeller is an additional 1.72 tons. So we're not talking about very heavy vehicles. It's all electrically driven, and it doesn't need a whole lot of wing area to get it airborne. As you can see, we're staying airborne, and this is without cheats. I don't have hack gravity turned on. Hack gravity is off. So it's able to keep airborne with very little effort. Of course, like in my previous video with the helicopters, you start having to combat precessional forces once you try to turn the aircraft. Let's see if I can come back to the runway and land, and we'll call the video quits because I think you get the idea. I said come back. Well, let's try going left. I was fiddling around with it earlier. It is very reluctant to do anything. Oh no, we're gonna stall. No! Well, I did land it earlier, honest. Alright, that's good enough. So I'll put a link for this in this particular plane, not the one we built, but this one, which is almost identical. Put a link for this in the description. You guys can go ahead and play with it. Do your own designs, and let's see what we can come up with. And if you want to, I think Vaos will have his stream up for maybe another couple days. You can go watch his effort at doing this, and he started out doing a twin propeller which, you know, it worked pretty well once he got managed to get both propellers working simultaneously. So that's also an option. All right, well, that's it for me. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.